Good afternoon, everybody. So welcome to this third lecture of the site investigation and soil exploration module supported by QEEE. So in today's lecture, we'll discuss some of the geophysical investigation which we do for the site investigation purpose. So before we actually discuss geophysical investigation, let us have a recap which we learnt last two lectures. So we discussed what is site investigation, and now as you all know, this site investigation plays a crucial role for the economic and safe design of and the choice of construction technique. So you need a sufficient information before you go for actual design. So site investigation, as we know, plays a very important role as far as geotechnical engineering is concerned. Now, as we already discussed, there are three important aspects. One is the exploration, the site exploration. Second is the laboratory testing and the in situ testing. So here we are focusing on exploration and in situ testing. We have already discussed exploration part, and now we started the in situ testing, where we mostly the common in situ tests we already discussed. Geophysical testing we are going to discuss now. So as we mentioned, there are three principal objects of site investigation. First is the sequence, thicknesses and lateral extents of the lateral soil strata, the level of bedrock. The second is the representative sample. Once you know the strata thickness, their lateral extent, the next is the level of the bedrock and the representative samples. So we need to collect representative samples. The third is the groundwater conditions. So three aspects. One is the strata thickness and the lateral extent, the sampling, the groundwater details. Now as we already discussed, there are four components involved in site investigation: the deck study, the preliminary site investigation, the detailed ground investigation and the geotechnical report. Already discussed this depth and related thing, depth of boring and their number. Then we also discussed the various types of soil boring techniques. We also discussed about soil sampling techniques, where we discussed about the disturbed sample and undisturbed samples and representative samples. So regarding method of soil boring, we already discussed there are four important type of borings. One is wash boring, then there is percussion drilling, and then rotary drilling and auger boring. So there are four different type of boring methods which commonly used. So some of the boring methods are used for sampling. For example, the rotary boring is good for sampling, whereas some of the methods like auger boring or the wash boring is not it is not suitable for sampling technique. Now some of the field tests we already discussed, like standard penetration test, dynamic cone penetration test, static cone penetration test, seismic cone penetration test, pressure meter test we discussed last class, and filled vein shear test and plate load test. So hope you could follow what are these important tests are, which are commonly used in geotechnical site investigation. So once you completely familiarize yourself on this various tests, you actually need to know something on the geotechnical investigation report, because there are four components as I mentioned. The last is the geotechnical investigation report, which has to be prepared after the site investigation is done. So there are various aspects related to the technical investigation report, which we discussed yesterday. Now, yesterday we discussed some of the in situ tests like pressure meter test, vane shear test, and the plate load test. So, just we'll have a small recap of the test. The pressure meter test, as you know, here we apply pressure through a probe in a borehole and deflect the ground. So, with the pressure volume characteristics, we try to get the modulus of the soil. So, as you see, there are two units. One will be the controller or the readout unit, another will be the probe unit, which will be used to inflate the soil. Okay. So, this the pressure volume characteristics we discussed, there are three zones which are important. The initial phase, which is the initial pressure to be applied to send the borehole to its original position, because once you make the borehole, there will be some kind of deformation in the borehole, which will reduce the dia. Later, you have to send the borehole to its original position. The next is the pseudoelastic phase, which is important for the modulus characterization. The last is the shear failure zone or plastic phase, which has to be, which is represented by zone 3. So, our concern is this zone 2, which is used for the calculation of modulus. The equation, concerned equation for this calculation of modulus, which is basically the pressure meter modulus, is given here, which is used to calculate. So, we all the terms are can be find out from the pressure volume characteristic curve, which just discussed. And from this pressure volume characteristics, one can find out the modulus of soil through correlation using some rheological factor, addition of rheological factor. Now, we also discussed plate load test. It is a semi-direct method of finding out the allowable pressure of the soil and the amount of settlement takes place. So, as you know, this plate load test is commonly used to as a model for the prototype foundation. Now, this particular diagram was discussed yesterday. As you can see here, jack is used to load a plate kept on the on a pit, and then the corresponding load deformation through this dial gauges is recorded, and from this load settlement characteristics is the bearing capacity correspond to a particular settlement limit is calculated. Now, some load settlement curves for different kind of soils, which we discussed, and the concerned equations which are used to find out the bearing capacity is already discussed. These are the equations for the first equation is for granular soil, and then another is cohesive soil. As I mentioned, the plate load test is mostly suitable for granular soil. For cohesive soil, it is not very suitable, as it takes time to dissipate the pore water pressure in case of cohesive soil because of its low permeability. So, obviously, for granular soil, it is mostly used, and if it is done, it has to be done cautiously in case of cohesive soil. Then we also discussed the vane shear test, where a vane is inserted on the ground, and the amount of torque required to shear the soil is basically recorded, which is used to find out the shear strength of the soil, the undrained shear strength. So, concerned equation which we discussed for the vane, when it is completely inserted, that means the both the top and the bottom portion of the vane is inside the soil. In case of borehole, the bottom equation is used. So, with this I will go to the now the geophysical investigation topic. So far whatever we discussed is mostly the in situ test related to either it is through instruments or mostly mechanical loading. Now here we are talking about the geophysical. That means here the concept of physics are mostly used for the characterization of the ground. Now as I mentioned, geophysical investigation basically the characterization of subsurface with the concept of physics or principles of physics. So as you know, soil and rock have different characteristics, different physical properties. Obviously they behave in a different way in different kind of environment, where whether it is wave propagation or it may be the electrical current. So definitely the ground will have a different characteristics in different kind of environment. So that characteristics, the behavior of this ground in different environment is basically used to characterize. Now there are different the main purpose related to this of this geophysical investigation is basically to find out the extent of mineral deposit. So earlier days mostly started using geophysical techniques for finding out the mineral deposit. As you know, minerals will have a different they will have a metal, if it is a metallic mineral, definitely it will be conductive, highly conductive, and the electrical current will pass very fast. So that way it can differ with the overlying material, overlying rock or soil. So that way the exploration will tell you whether there is some mineral deposit or not. Then different layers of soil and rock, that also can be characterized using geophysical. For example, if you pass some electrical current, different strata will have a different conductivity or resistivity. So that that characteristics will tell you whether layers are there is a single layer or various different layers are there in the ground. Then determination of underground sewage lines, pipeline, cables, etc. also can be determined using geophysical techniques. So there are different techniques are available. So we can divide the geophysical techniques in two major groups. One is mechanical wave based, where you use the mechanical wave measurements. The other is electromagnetic wave techniques. So either you use mechanical wave measurements or electromagnetic wave measurements. So in mechanical wave measurements, you can use seismic refraction test, where actual sound waves you can pass and record to find out or to characterize the ground. So in this you have tests like crosshole tests, downhole tests, spectral analysis, surface wave, seismic refraction tests, and like suspension logging. And then we in electromagnetic wave techniques, we have surface resistivity techniques, magnetometer surveys, ground penetrating radars, electromagnetic conductivity. These are some tests. So as far as this course is, this lecture is concerned, we will focus on very specific geophysical techniques which are commonly used, because many of the tests are not commonly used, although mentioned here. So first we will discuss the electrical resistivity method, which is a electromagnetic based technique, wave based technique, which is used to characterize the ground. So what is this electrical resistivity technique to characterize the ground? So as the name implies, electrical resistivity method, that means it uses resistivity of the material to characterize. Now as you know, conductivity is basically the ability of any material to allow current to pass through it. Now the inverse of this conductivity is resistivity. The ground, as you know, different ground will have a different resistivity against passing electrical current. So this characteristics of the ground is actually used to characterize it. So for example, if there is a soil, it will have a one particular resistivity, and then if you have some rock, it will have a different value. So you can distinguish whether where the rock strata is starting or where the soil is, the soil rock interface is there. Similarly, if in rock, if it is fractured rock, it will have a one kind of resistivity, and again if it is a sound good quality rock without any fracture, it will have a different kind of resistivity. So this resistivity actually helps us to characterize the ground, whether it is different strata or even the same strata, what type of whether it is fractured or if it is, if there is any anomaly, okay, that also can be characterized based on the change in the resistivity. Now in this technique, basically what we do is we use some electrodes. So two electrodes for passing electrical current, and then another two to measure the potential difference. So as you know, if there is some resistivity in the material, it will generate some kind of potential. So that potential difference is measured with some potential electrode. For example, in case of tube light, what exactly you do to increase the potential, you use some choke. So similarly here, as you see, if the ground is having some resistivity, obviously there will be some kind of potential developed which will be recorded. So as I mentioned, there will be two electrodes mostly, which will which is a current electrode, which will allow pass current the ground, and the another two which will be used for measuring the potential, and then the resistivity of the material will be finding out, can be calculated using this equation. Rho is equal to 2 pi d v, v is the voltage and I is the current, V by I, or V is the measured potential difference in volts and I is the current introduced in ampere. I which you are going to use and V is which you are going to measure from the ground. Now that D, the distance is basically as here mentioned. So there are two electrodes, which is basically the current electrodes as you can see here. So and this two electrodes is basically the potential electrodes, which will give you the this voltage, the potential in volt, potential difference. So here as you can see, the all electrodes are kept at the same distance d, that is the d, we call this as Wenner arrangement. So this is arrangement was developed by Wenner arrangement, and the another is Thumberger arrangement, which is where if you are using different lengths for the potentials. So in other case, if your distance are not same, the distance between the electrodes are not same, then you have to measure the distance between the potential electrode and the distance between the current electrodes. So here in this particular figure, as you can see here, the this current electrodes, you have a length L, and the voltage, the potential difference, potential electrodes actually you have B, distance B. So the resistivity can be calculated using this equation, where pi is equal to L by 2 square minus B by 2 square divided by B delta V by I, that is the voltage difference and the current which you have applied. So with this two arrangements, we can characterize the ground with four electrodes. Now when you use some kind of arrangement like here, you will get a complete typical circuit of for resistivity in the field. So as you can see here, a homogeneous ground will get a this electrical field like this. So you have, as you can see, there will be some kind of equipotential line, and then there will be current line, so which will be perpendicular to the equipotential line. So these two lines, like current lines and equipotential lines, are perpendicular to each other. So if you remember your CPage class, there the flow name and the seepage lines, and the flow are there perpendicular to that. They are also, they are equipotential lines, and the flow lines are perpendicular to the other. Okay, so that similar line here also you can see they are perpendicular to each other. So this particular field is basically for the homogeneous. If the ground is not homogeneous or different layers are there, this configuration will, this field will change accordingly, and then that has to be characterized. Now our objective of using this electrical resistivity to characterize the ground where different layers are there, which usually we encounter, we are try to find out. Now how to use this technique which is just explained to characterize the ground or different layers of ground. As you can see here, as you have different layers, as you increase the distance of these electrodes, you can have a larger penetration. Of course, if you increase the distance, your amount of current also need to be increased accordingly, so that you can have a right amount of current for that ground. Okay, so in this particular case, you can see where Wiener configuration is used, where all the electrodes are kept at distance d, and the current is actually also passing through this layer 2. So that means when these lines are passing through here, they will have a one particular resistivity, and this particular ground will have a other kind of resistivity. So then the potential will be different in two different cases. So as you increase the different dimensions with, so if you go on changing the dimension and measure the potential, you will get a curve, okay, you will get a graph like this. As you can see, initially we have, as you change the distance, it is having single the straight line, that means it is homogeneous. Once you reach to this point, your slope is changing, that means you are getting a different resistivity initially. So as you increase, as you change the d, as you change the value d, distance between the electrodes, the corresponding resistivity will also change at some particular point. After that, the slope of the line will change. So we'll get a resistivity versus distance graph, and correspondingly slope you can find out. Okay, so empirical, this is the basic method which you use to find out the resistivity of the ground. Now the measured potential difference is weighted value over a subsurface region. So when you are calculating the potential difference, these are the weighted value over a subsurface region. Okay, controlled by the shape of the region, and yields an apparent resistivity over an unspecified depth. So true resistivity will get when you have a homogeneous kind of layer or single layer, but when you have so many layers or the ground is changing with depth, you will get a apparent resistivity, which is the weighted value or the averaged value. So here, as I mentioned here, true and actual resistivity is basically if the formation is homogeneous and isotropic. We'll get a apparent resistivity if the formation is anisotropic, consisting of two or more layers of different materials. In that case, a average value will give you an apparent resistivity. Now, as I already mentioned, the changing the spacing of electrodes changes the depth of the penetration. So as you change the electrode, their distance, the depth of penetration, that means if you can reach to a greater depth of the ground. So in case your domain, or you can, if you want to know much more deep of the ground, or much more depth of the ground is need to be characterized, you can accordingly select your distance of electrodes. So it is possible to obtain field curve of apparent resistivity versus depth corresponding to different distance of electrodes. for a single homogeneous isotropic layer of infinite thickness, resistivity curve will be straight line, as I mentioned. For single layers where there is no change in the resistivity, we will get a straight line. Some of the resistivity values for some of the ground material like sand, you have resistivity value ohm meter. As you can see here, this value changes varies from 500 to 1500. As we can guess, for ground they are very highly variable actually. Even when you call sand, different places will get a different kind of characteristics. So that's why so much variation is there. It may vary from 500 to 1500. Now, if you have a clay or saturated silt, the resistivity will vary from 0 to 100. In case of clay sand, you'll get a 200 to 500. And if you have a gravel, your resistivity values will vary from 1500 to 4000 ohm meter. And as you can see, for rock, a good quality rock, the resistivity is more than 5000. But in case of weathered rock, it is 1500 to 2500 ohm meter. So these are some values, some range basically, and it may vary from place to place. So good, as you can see here, the range is quite large in case of materials, the earth materials. Now, as you saw, it's a very simple technique. The resistivity method is a very simple technique to characterize the ground. Sometimes, as a independent method may not be sufficient to characterize the ground. Definitely, you need to supplement it with, or it has to be used as a supplement to the actual ground investigation using some borehole methods. So there are, as you can see here, the method can be used to determine depth and thickness of subsurface layers, depth of water table, bedrock. As you can see, even water table can be find out using resistivity technique. As you know, like when you have saturated zone, you have a different resistivity. So it can be easily, the information can be captured easily. Now, profiling can be used to detect and locate contaminant plumes also. Many times, many of the places you'll know that there are some kind of contaminant or leakage of some kind of contaminant. So that kind of the situation, if you want to know to what lateral extent or what depth it is, it has reached or it has expanded. So in that case, the plume size can be determined or plume volume can be determined using this technique very easily. We have resistivity values can be used to estimate geological formation as well. As you know, geological formation, you have different type of layers, different type of rock, different type of soils. So this resistivity technique can easily characterize this different type of layers. Now, there are a lot of advantages to use this electrical resistivity techniques. At the same time, you have some limitation as well. As you know, resistivity, sometimes resistivity data may be a little ambiguous, and proper interpretation is a must, because two different material sometimes may show a similar type of resistivity, and then you need to characterize it with caution. That's the reason why it can be supplemented with some other method of investigation as well. For example, actual borehole to that depth is definitely will help to know the actual layering. Now, distinction of layers, sometimes if there is no sometimes the layerings are not very distinct, it is difficult to know. So distinction of layers may be properly interpreted. Electrical resistivity is relatively slow because we have to fix the electrodes, and then the measurement has to be made. So sometimes it takes little time, but still in my opinion, it's a very useful technique and can be easily done in the various different type of grounds. Now, other related limitation is if you have some kind of electrical power lines, as you know, like if you have some conductive lines like electrical power lines or utilities, sometimes you will have water lines or some kind of fences. So this will interfere your test. So obviously in case if you have some kind of electrical power lines, utilities or some kind of fences, you have to be very cautious or careful while doing the test. And many a times if that electrical power lines are there, the current will flow through this power lines very easily. So the current that will interfere your test. Now many a time some of the layers will be very conductive in nature in the ground. So that case the result may be little confusing, because that gives a higher current. You are applying higher current, so the flow will be very large in that particular layer. So along the current will always travel most easily along highly conductive layers. If the surface is highly conductive, it may not possible to collect data below the top layer. So as you know, if there are some kind of electrical lines or there is a specific conductive layers, you have to be cautious while doing the electrical resistivity test. Now the next test we commonly do is the seismic refraction test. So as you can make out from the name itself, seismic refraction method, that means there are some kind of seismic waves are there which are used to characterize the ground. So this particular method, so is in this method basically the travel time of seismic waves are used, and the refraction at the interfaces is used to characterize the ground. Now when I say that you have to use some seismic waves to characterize the ground, that means you need some source of this seismic waves. How you can generate these seismic waves? So there are ways you can use some kind of seismic hammers which can generate some seismic waves, and then the corresponding seismic waves will be recorded at different points. The travel time of those waves is actually going to characterize the ground. So as you can see here, this particular picture, we have some source of seismic waves, and then you have different recording points, that is the geofence, which will record this waves as it reaches there. So the wave will reach to this geofence through different layers. As the depth at the distance increases, it will reach through larger depth. So those waves will reach passing through various layers, and then and refracted at the interfaces, then this seismic waves will be recorded these geophones and used for the characterization purpose. Now the seismic wave travel through the subsurface at a velocity dependent on the density of the rock. As you know, the waves have velocity which is dependent on the density. Higher the density means higher the velocity of seismic waves, or velocity of sound rather. So as you can see, for example, if you knock the wood, you will get a very dull sound. That means the wood is having very low, relatively low velocity of sound or velocity of seismic waves, and of course the density also relatively low. On the other hand, if you knock some metal, you will get a very good sound. That means it is having a very good high velocity of seismic waves, and yet its density also very high. So obviously they are related, density and seismic wave or velocity of sounds are related. When the seismic wave front encounters an interface, what exactly happens? You have different layers of strata, and objective of this test is to characterize that, or to find out where exactly those interface is, because you need to know what are those layers which are actually beneath the ground. So when the seismic wave front encounters an interface where seismic velocity drastically increases. So as you see, if there is a change in the strata, there will be some kind of the change in the velocity also. And a portion of the wave critically refracts at the interface. If you remember that when at a particular incident angle, some of the waves will critically refract along the interface. So there will be some reflection and some of the refract, but there will be some waves which will critically refract. So those critically refracted waves which will follow the interface of the layers, and then some, because of the compressional stresses, some of the waves will come back to the surface and will get recorded. So as I mentioned, due to the compressional stresses along the interface boundary, a portion of the wave front returns to the surface. Those returned waveforms actually will characterize the interface. Now, as you can see, this seismic refraction test, you have seismic waves. That means the travel times of P and S waves. The seismic waves, mostly the body waves, P and S waves are used from an impulse source to a linear array of points along the ground surface at different distances from the source. So this P and S waves are actually used to characterize the ground. We'll discuss what exactly this P and S wave. Most of you may be knowing this. The output of all these receivers recorded when the impulse load is triggered. So those, all the geophones, it may be 24 channel, so, or maybe 48 channels, all those geophones will record the travel time of this P and S waves. As you know, P is faster than the S waves, so you will record P wave faster. So arrival time of first waves to reach each receiver are determined and plotted as a function of the source receiver distance. Now this used for determination of wave velocity and thickness of each layer and the dip angle. Now this information will be helpful to know the depth of various layers. Now before I go further, I'll just briefly tell you what exactly these P waves and S waves, which are used to characterize the ground in seismic refraction technique. So the primary waves, as in Wikipedia they have given some definition, nice definition. So these are compressional waves, as you know, that are longitudinal in nature. So compressional waves which are longitudinal in nature. P waves are pressure waves that travel faster than other waves through the earth to arrive at seismograph stations first, hence the name primary. These waves can travel through any type of medium. So as you know, P waves can travel any medium, whether it is water, whether it is fluid, whether it is a solid medium. Okay. And travel at nearly twice the speed of, so almost it is double the speed of S waves, that is the shear waves. In air, that it takes the speed of sound waves. When it is in air, it is almost same like sound waves, and they travel at a speed of 330 meter per second and 1450 meter per second in water and about 5000 meters per second in rock like granite. So as you can see, the P wave velocity is drastically different in different medium, which information is very useful to characterize the ground. As you can see, when it is in water, it is having a speed of 1450, and when it is in sound rock like granite, the speed is 5000. So obviously, if you have a different material, we'll have a different kind of velocity of seismic waves. That information will be helpful to characterize. The other wave, which is secondary, or the S waves, are shear waves. They are transverse in nature. So it reaches after the P waves to the receiver, and depending on the propagation direction, the wave can take a different surface characteristics, and the ground move alternatively to one side than the other while the S waves travels. So as you may be knowing, this S waves cannot travel through fluid, as fluid doesn't have shear stress. So you may not get, if you have a fluid, you will get only P wave, and the S wave will not reach to your geophones. So in that case, you will come to know that, oh, there is some kind of a fluid which is there, which is obstructing your S waves. Now the other is the surface waves, which follows the surface of the earth during which we are not concerned much as far as this seismic refraction test is concerned, but in case of earthquakes is very important. The surface waves are also play a very important role. Now as I mentioned, there are three different type of waves: P waves, S wave and surface waves. So as you can see how their movement is. So it's in the longitudinal direction, in the shear wave is in transverse direction. So the particle movement is, as you can see here, along the wave direction. In this case, it is perpendicular to that wave direction. Okay. So this characteristics actually is this, because of this, the travel time also changes, and the wave P wave reaches faster than S wave. Now coming to this particular seismic refraction test setup or the method, as you can see, when as I already shown you, there is the source of seismic waves where you generate the seismic waves, then you have various geophones where you receive the signals. Now as you can see here, when you generate some waves, the different geophones will receive the signals at different time. The time will be in a millisecond, even less than that. So that millisecond will be recorded, the difference, and then that will be helpful to characterize the ground. Now if you see this travel time versus the distance for different geophones, as you can see here, it reaches a different time for different distance. So that curve is actually useful for the characterization. Now ultimately what we need to do in case of seismic refraction test is we need to characterize the ground. That means we have to characterize the different layers of soil or rock. Now as you can see, when you have multiple layers, you will have a different velocity of sound or velocity of seismic waves. So that means the waves or the seismic waves will reach to the geophones at different time if it follows different layers. So that information will be recorded, and then that is going to help you to characterize. Now as you see here, for different layers we'll get a different kind of the travel time, and then you will get a different the slope of the travel time versus distance will change. The slope of the line will change as you consider the different strata. Now the first step when you are analyzing the data, what exactly we need to do is to obtain the times of the first arrival T1 to all the T1, T2, T3 at various distances of X1, X2 and X3. So your geophones are there at different distances. So the travel time to those geophones are recorded, though there will be T1, T2, T3 and TN. Now this plot of this time against the distance X is done, and the graph will look like this, which will have a different slope. Now the slope of the lines is basically calculated, the AB, BC and CD for corresponding to different travel time is find out. Now this actually the given by the inverse of the V1, V2 and V3. that will give you the velocity. So here v1, v2, v3 are the few wave velocities in layer 1, 2, 3 respectively. So if you have three layers, as you can see here, the slope, the inverse of the slope will give you the velocity v1, v2 and v3 respectively. Now you are getting different velocities for different layers using geophones based on the different travel time. Now how to get the thickness of the layers, because you know that there are different layers and those layers are having a travel time of v1, v2, v3. Now if you know the travel time for different layers, you can find out the thickness using, if you have a two layers, you can use this equation, half v2 minus, so for the first two layers, if you can use v2 minus v1 root v2 plus v1 root over into xc. As you can see, the first depth is basically the xc. Now you can where value of xc can be obtained from the plot here, as you can see here, you can find out this xc from this. This is the distance xc for this particular first two layers. Okay. Now this xc can be calculated and can be used to find out the thickness of the layer z1. Similarly, for multiple layers, more than two layers, you can use this equation where you have v3 also, v2, v3, v1, all three velocities are needed to calculate the thickness of the layers. Now as you can see here, you have different layers, you are having vp1, vp2 and vpn, and then you will get a different slopes corresponding to different layers. And the same, as you can see here, you have arrival time and you have different xc1, xc2 and xc3 for corresponding to different layers. And from there you can find out the various thicknesses. So h1, h2, h3 can be find out from different velocities corresponding to different x1, x2 and x3. Now you saw that with the seismic refraction techniques, you can characterize the ground with the seismic geophones. Once you have the source and the recording through geophones, now those velocities of different layers will be varying. Now a rough idea on that that velocities will be like this. If for soil, different soils, as I mentioned, you have a different few velocities in meter per second. For sand, silt or fine grained topsoils, you can have a 200 to 1000. You have alluvium, you have 500 to 2000. Compacted clays, the P wave velocity is 1000 to 2500. Then you have for lows, it is 250 to 750. Now as you can see, the velocity of sound for the topsoil, where either it's sand, clay, or this may be the compacted clays. Okay, so their velocities are relatively low. The moment it reaches, you go a little deeper, you may encounter rock, and then the velocity will rise drastically. So that will tell you where exactly your rock layer is. Okay, so as you can see here, there is a big difference in the velocities of the soft soil and rock. For rock, even for ordinary rock like shale sandstone, you have velocities which are more than 2000. Okay, and if you go to the some good quality rock like granite, basalt, your the speed of P wave velocity will be almost 5000 or 6000 meter per second. Now even in a particular rock, if they have a different kind of fractures or different kind of joints or the disturbance, then we'll have a different velocity. So even in a particular rock, if you want to characterize based on this seismic wave velocities, you can characterize the ground. So some other materials which I discussed, like different materials will have a different kind of seismic wave velocity. As you can see here, for air it is varying from 300 to 360. For water it is 14 100 to 1500, and then other material like granite, basalt, you have 4000, 3000 meter per second. So as you see here, for different kind of materials, different type of ground materials, you will have a different kind of velocity of elastic wave. What exactly happens if the ground is saturated? If it is saturated, the velocity will be different in different situations. As you can see, in case of unsaturated ground, different materials like soil will have one kind of velocity. Okay, for loose sand, gravel, silt, whatever velocity is there, it will drastically change when they are saturated. You can see the when they are the same soil is saturated. You can see, for example, the top soil organic material is having a seismic wave velocity from 100 to 200, but in case it is saturated, your velocity is almost 1500. So as you can see here, the saturation has a drastic effect on this velocity of sound or velocity of seismic waves. So the travel time of waves depends on media. The greatest in case of igneous, as you know, especially the consolidated rocks, they are highly consolidated, granite, basalt, they are consolidated rocks, and least in unconsolidated, relatively poorly consolidated rocks will have a relatively lower velocity of. Now the other aspect in this is the velocity increases in case the material is saturated in comparison with unsaturated material. Okay. So velocity will change with the saturation. Now there are some limitations as far as this seismic refraction techniques is concerned. Although it's very suitable, very much suitable to characterize the ground with different layers having different kind of seismic velocities. But in case there is no clear cut demarcation of the layers, it is may not be the test may not be very easy to characterize the ground. So that means the velocity of the contrast from one layer to other should be very good. Otherwise, you may not be able to characterize where is the interface or where is the layer ending. So in case the layer has two layers are completely distinct and they have a different velocity of sound, you can definitely very nicely characterize the layers. Other thing is, in case you have upper strata denser, sometimes it happens that you have a layers which is relatively softer compared to upper layer of the ground. In that case, not very successful. So because, as you know, the refraction angle will change into the opposite if it refracts from denser to lighter medium. Okay. So the waves which you are expected to come to the surface will actually may not come, where it will go to the other direction, and then receiver may not receive the signals properly. Then the other aspect related to this seismic refraction test is the surface terrain. The surface terrain and the interfaces of the layers are if steeply sloping method may not be very suitable. So if it is a flat surface, even the interfaces are flat, relatively this method is very efficient. So next we'll go to the crosswell test. If you have any questions, you can pass on to me. So as you saw in these two methods of site characterization, these two methods of geophysical technique, we use either the electrical current or the seismic waves to characterize the ground. As ground having ground, different ground or different strata have different kind of conductive characteristics or different resistivity. So you can use the information to characterize the ground, or you have different seismic wave velocity in different ground. So that information can be used to characterize the ground. So the same seismic, similar to this seismic refraction technique, where you actually have a source on the ground and then geophones lying at a different distance from the source, we can try to characterize the ground. We can use Some other methods like crosswell method, which is also a seismic method, which where you generate some waves which and record at some particular distance. So this is a crosswell called the crosswell technique, where your source is actually both the source and the receiver is in the bore hole. How to, so the question is, BEC College, thank you for asking this question. As I mentioned, using geophysical technique, we can characterize different minerals. So we can use geophysical technique like electrical resistivity to characterize that. Now, as you know, the resistivity of different minerals are different, and even water has a different resistivity. So obviously, a mineral and water will have, can be easily characterized using electrical resistivity technique. Even a particular rock mineral, or maybe the ore body rather, because as you go down, you actually recover the ore which contains the mineral. Now, suppose that is fully saturated or water is there, it will have a one kind of conductivity, and if it is dry, another kind of conductivity. So using electrical resistivity technique, you can clearly characterize that, cross hole test. Similarly, we also have downhole test, but we'll just limit ourselves to this cross hole test, which is also common as far as geotechnical site investigation is concerned. Okay, so as you can, as the name implies, this is a cross hole test. That means, and moreover, this is a seismic test where you, instead of generating the seismic wave at the surface, you actually generate the seismic wave at some at a source located at some depth in the borehole. Okay, and the source also the receiver also kept at some another borehole at the same level. Okay, so before I discuss in detail, just show you the diagram for this particular test. As you can see here, this particular, see, in seismic refraction test, what you followed is basically you have generated some source, and at different distance you have tried to record the seismic wave, the travel time. But in this particular case, you are having different holes in the ground, and you are using that holes you are trying to characterize. So similar to your seismic refraction test, here also you must have some source through which you generate the seismic waves. So at suppose you want to characterize the ground at this level, you must have your source at that depth. You lower your source to that depth, you can use some small quantity of blasting to generate some seismic waves, and then at the same level you can keep your sources. In this particular hole you are keeping one source and as a receiver, the other hole also you can have one more receiver. So what exactly happens at the same level, you are generating the seismic waves and you are recording, so you know the distance, and that from this travel time you can find out the characteristics, because different material will have a different travel time of seismic waves. So if you know the distance, you know the velocity, so once with that you can characterize the ground. So as you can see here, borehole is there, and we also have some casing. Sometimes in soil the borehole may not be stable, so you need to have some kind of casing as well. Now these test methods are limited to the determination of the velocity of two types of horizontally traveling seismics in soil material, the P wave and the secondary wave, and the S waves. As I mentioned, in seismic waves we mostly focus on P waves and S waves, so both thing can be characterized using this technique. It is assumed that the method used to analyze the data obtained is based on the first arrival time or the interval arrival time over a mere distance. So the interval, time interval at which the seismic wave reaches the destination is basically recorded and used to characterize the ground. So it measures directly, as you saw in the diagram, you have a source, you have a receiver at same level, and then you are directly measuring the wave propagation, the velocity of that waves, and that will give you velocity of the ground and then corresponding material characteristic. So what exactly you do here, you at selected depth down the borehole, you generate some seismic waves as I showed you, and then you downhole receivers are used to detect the arrival of the seismic wave train just very near to the actual hole, source hole. And usual recommended distance is 3 to 6 meter. The distance between the borehole at the test depth is measured using borehole deviation survey. Sometimes what exactly happens, boreholes which you drill may not be straight. So now your top distance may be 6 meter, but you don't know the exact distance. Suppose this borehole is not vertical. Sometimes when you drill, the alignment changes, that we call borehole deviation. Now if there is some deviation, what exactly happens, that the you have fixed the distance of the top, this point to this point, but your source is here and this is not exactly below this point. So what will happen, this distance will change from this the top distance. So that has to be checked properly with a borehole deviation measurement at the particular level, which will give you the exact distance between the source, the seismic wave generation source, and the receiver where you actually going to receive the wave. Now the response of the downhole receivers are recorded, thus measuring the travel time of the wave train between the source and the receiver. So now the P and S wave velocity is calculated from the measured distance as and the travel time for the respective wave train. So you have the distance, fixed distance which the wave actually travels, from the time and the distance you can calculate the velocity, and once you know the velocity you can indirectly characterize the ground. If you want to know the complete characteristics of your ground, you have to repeat the test at different levels. Like for example, you have done a test here, then you can do just another test below this, the test, and another test below that. So you can have a number of tests done in that borehole and boreholes, and then you will get that velocities at different levels. So if that layers is changing at with depth, we will get a different velocities of seismic waves, which tells you that what kind of strata is there. If suppose here you have getting some velocity, after that some rock layer starts. So definitely here the velocity, once you reach to the rock layer, your velocity will be relatively higher. So that will give you that, okay, after this you have a, at this point you got some lower velocity, after that you are getting a very high velocity. So that is basically rock, or what kind of rock. The data may be used for this particular crosshole test, may be useful for various applications, like for input the static and dynamic analysis, the calculation of shear modulus, Young's modulus, and Poisson's ratio. The velocity can be used to find out this. There are correlations available, and then we can find out the seismic site studies of the site can be done using that velocities. And many a times if it is earthquake prone area, or maybe the what you call seismically active region, you also need to do the liquefaction studies. So that shear wave velocities will tell you whether the ground is liquefiable or not. The ground penetrating radar, which this particular three test mostly we do. The recent days we are also trying to find out if there is something buried in the ground. So ground penetrating radar, many of you have might have seen or heard about this ground penetrating radar, which just briefly tell you, because this is relatively new and mostly used rather than investigation. Mostly if you have some, suppose some buried pipelines, because these days when you are excavating something, there will be lot of electrical lines, pipelines, water pipelines, or maybe some kind of other buried objects which are there, just need to investigate it. So as you see, this ground penetrating radar It is again a electromagnetic based wave based technique. It's a high resolution, high frequency, that is 10 megahertz to 1000 megahertz wave technique for imaging soils and ground structures. So there will be one antenna with this ground penetrating radar, and this transmits and receives the pulses. So it's it generates pulse and generates pulse and then transmits that pulse to the ground. And if there is some buried object, it reflect back some of the pulses, which again it records, and that information actually is used to know whether there is some kind of buried object. So as I mentioned, this particular penetrating radar is mostly used to find out in case you have buried objects there in the site or not. So this GPR is basically continuously done in the ground in particular grid, and then continuous resolution images of the soil profile with no or very little soil disturbance is received. Okay, so as you can see here, GPR is mounted on a small vehicle which is crawled on the ground, and then this pulses which are generated from this radar is basically reflected back with some buried, or if you have some pipeline or some kind of object, and that information is used to characterize the ground. So we will get a signals like this, which is a typical signal will look like this, which will be if you have some clay or some kind of utility like a pipeline or a sewage line or maybe the electrical lines, will get some kind of different signals at that particular zone and can be characterized. Okay. So if you have a change in the strata, that will be reflected in the signals, which will be analyzed to find out where exactly those interfaces are. So as you see, this is relatively new method which is commonly used to characterize the ground. GPR is not suitable for highly conductive wet clays and silt. So it is not very suitable in that case if it is highly conductive in nature. And as you know, the GPR is not very suitable for a larger depth. So resolution will be very poor and we may not be able to properly characterize for very greater depth. So but now these days sophisticated GPR with very high high penetration also available. So with this methods, with this geophysical techniques, I'll conclude this particular lecture. And as you saw, we discussed first the geophysical technique using electrical resistivity, then we seismic refraction, then cross hole, and then a brief on ground penetrating radar. So mostly we try to focus on three methods. One is electrical resistivity, second is seismic refraction, and then cross hole technique. So there are many other techniques, geophysical techniques for the characterization of the ground, but whatever we discussed is mostly used, commonly used. So obviously the basics of is relevant for this particular lecture. If you have any questions on this topic, please, or maybe the earlier whatever we discussed can be asked now. You can pass your questions. Once a sample is TKM College, once a sample is taken, how long can be used without any appreciable change in its? It's always good to do the test as early as possible, because there will be some kind of, even you preserve the sample very well, but there may be change in the this water content or moisture content. It's better to do the test early. It's difficult to say actually how long you can wait. If you can preserve it properly, you can wait for weeks, but it's better to do the test as early as possible to avoid any kind of change. What will be the effect of shadow zone while sending the seismic waves? This shadow zone actually comes because there is, if there is no inform, like if the wave doesn't pass. So as you know, P wave passes both solid and liquid, but the S waves doesn't pass through fluid because they are shear waves, they, and fluid doesn't have any shear strength. Now because of that, what exactly happened, there will be some kind of shadow zone where there is no wave passing through that, the seismic. So that means there are saturated, you can say that there fluid is there or maybe some highly saturated. In case if you find some shadow zone, that means there are some kind of some information on the this water or some kind of fluid which reflects that. Okay, SBEC College, your question is which method is more accurate for finding out the groundwater table? Obviously groundwater table, if you want to know, there are methods like CPTU, if you are doing the test using cone penetration test with pore pressure transducers, that will be really very effective. Coming to the geophysical techniques, obviously the seismic, both the seismic technique, seismic refraction method or electrical instrumentation method also can be used, but obviously supplemented, should be supplemented with actual boreholes, and that boreholes will give you the information on the groundwater table. So mostly for groundwater table we use piezometers, which is installed in the ground, and then any fluctuation in the groundwater table is recorded or monitored regularly. Well, the question is, define on bearing capacity from observed velocity of resistivity. See, velocity you get from refraction technique, or from the electrical resistivity technique, you get the resistivity value from, as you know, different materials will have a different resistivity, so you'll get the characteristics of the material. So if you get to know that what type of material it is, like for example, if you have a particular rock type or particular soil type which you encountered there, so now with that soil, what will be the corresponding capacity, you can approximately find out. So that way is basically to characterize the ground through this geophysical techniques, and then from that ground characteristics you are actually trying to find out the bearing capacity. So next stage, once you know the ground, obviously you can go ahead with the, to finding out how much approximate capacity would be. Oh, slip friction, that is in our CPT test, cone penetration test, where you saw the two important parameter which you record in cone penetration test. One is the tip resistance, that is the load cell which is kept just beside the cone. The other is the slip friction, that is the friction between the probe or the cone rod and the surrounding soil. So that friction, the ratio of that friction and the tip resistance actually is used to characterize the ground. Okay, so BC College has asked one question on which one is the most precise method for determining the thickness of layers. So obviously if you ask this question, thickness of layers, so the most precise would be only when you do actual borehole and get the bore logs. Okay, you do a drilling, get the samples at different layers, and then see that, and what is the layer thickness, and that also the layer thickness changes at different locations. So you have to have a multiple boreholes to completely characterize the ground. Okay, if you ask for most precise, if you are to just find out the simple method to characterize the strata thickness, obviously some geophysical techniques, if precisely interpreted, systematically done, can give you the layer thickness. Even the regularly used seismic refraction technique, that is can be used, like we are using regularly the MASW, that method is suitable to find out different layers or the shear wave velocities at different layers. What are the types of electrodes used for electrical resistivity method? When current is passed, will not the soil properties changes due to electrochemical? See, here we are more particular about a larger site in a larger scale. The local there will be some changes, but which not may not affect in a larger domain. So especially for applications like site investigation, it may not be a major factor and can be neglected. So can be effectively used, the electrical resistivity method can be effectively used to characterize the ground. PCTN question, the core boring core barrels provide with diamond studded bit commonly used instead of diamond, any other material can you use? Okay, so in case of core boring, we use mostly diamond bits. Even tungsten carbide, they are also very hard material, the hard bits can be used. So it's possible, but mostly used thing is the bits with diamond bits.
Okay.
Can we totally rely on geophysical investigation alone? Asked by GCT College. Usually use these geophysical techniques as a supplement to the regular investigation techniques like boreholes or SPT, other where you directly observe the details. Geophysical is indirect method, so definitely as a standalone method may not be that reliable. Even when we do independently the geophysical, if it is interpreted properly, definitely can be used because the method is well proven and it is highly successful in most of the cases. But the results has to be interpreted with caution and with experience, you need to properly interpret. The seismic GCT College asking one question on the seismic refraction method effective in loose soil condition. Obviously seismic refraction, if as I mentioned, like the seismic technique is like the ground has to be firm and like it's horizontal, but even if it is loose, if it is accordingly the velocities will be different, it can be characterized. So for loose sand also, kind of situation also, it can be used. Seismic refraction technique can be used. But you need a proper base to do this kind of test. So that required little, if a good strata would be really helpful in that case. So for generating the source of the seismic wave, you need a proper base. Which will generate the seismic waves, and then the receivers can be at some loose material as well, which can be recorded. GCT student is asking, what are the corrections we need to keep in mind while doing cone penetrometer? So cone penetration, the data is subjected to some kind of misinformations, like some kind of errors, like it gives the average values while penetration. Okay, so in case if you have a very thin layers, weak layers, sometimes you may overlook. So that way, when while interpreting the data, one need to be very careful. As such, there is need not to be corrections like SPT. But the data has to be interpreted properly. Many times it happens that a desiccated clay can be represented as sand. So because of the friction recorded. So one need to be careful while interpreting the cone penetrometer data before using. So if there is no more questions, I really thank you for your patience listening, and really enjoyed this online lecture, and I am thankful to K QEEE for giving me the opportunity. And I just one more question I need to be taken from PEC taken college. How far depth GPR is suitable? Okay, so this GPR is ground penetrating radar. It depends on the size of antenna or the how, what is the frequency for low. It has to be lower frequency to have a better penetration. So depending on the different like there are lot of companies which manufactures GPR, and depending on the size of antenna, the frequency is actually responsible for that. But a 30 meter would be a reasonable depth up to which or 20 to 30 meters up to 30 meters reasonable well information we can get. Okay, thank you very much for your patience listening. Okay, and for any additional questions if you have related to this topic of geotechnical site investigation, you can write to me. I'll try to answer if possible. Okay, and with your with this, I just try to conclude. I'll conclude the session. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.